Hello, welcome to Rahalastapa. This week's guest is Sarah Millican. I forgot to do the product placement during the recording. It is for this. Inspired by the do-it-yourself ethos of Rahalastapa. Rahalastapa, I super keen am planning to put on film screenings in London, including some weird and wonderful curiosities of cinema. By the time this podcast is released, dates and venues for the first few screenings should be up on the super keen website and Twitter feed. Show sign. I have been shown it. The first set of events will hopefully include Ted Post's The Baby, a demented thriller about the custody battle between a group of women for an adult man baby that escalates into bizarre horror. Alan Funt's What Do You Say to a Naked Lady, in which the man behind candid camera examines sexual mores of the general public at the end of the 60s. And Melvin Van Peebles' Watermelon Man, a 1970 satire on American race relations that deserves to be better known today. So do go and support Super Kino if you can. Superkino.com. And also come see me on tour. Go to richcherring.com/gigs and you can see if I'm coming with my show, The Best, to a town near you very soon. Let's sit back and enjoy Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre podcast. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Leicester Square Theatre. Please welcome a man who was standing in an unpleasant fart cloud about 2 hours ago on a tube, which was not his own. It's Richard Herring. Thank you very much. Hello. Welcome to Series 10, Episode 15 of Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre podcast. But I was down at Shrek Adventure London the other day. It's good they put Shrek in it. It's good. You should go and see it. And there was a man dressed as a Shrek there. He called it Rahalastapa. I know that's going to catch on. So I was on the tube on the way. This is a difficult situation. I was on the tube on the way here and I was standing. It was quite a packed tube. And then somebody had done a really horrible, really nasty fart that sort of drifted in. And it's difficult to know how to respond, isn't it? Because you don't want anyone to think it's you who's done it. But if you overreact that, it looks like you're acting like you haven't done it because you've done it. And the train pulled into a station. I thought, I can't, it's horrible, but if I get off and move to another carriage, everyone will think I did it. So we all just had to, it was a Mexican standoff. That is not racist. I'm not saying they fart more. But I would build a wall to stop it. That is what I'm saying. And I'd make them pay for the farts. In France. I was in London Zoo yesterday. I took my young family and some friends with kids. We went to London. It's very good, London Zoo. Although it's a sort of weird thing because there's animals encaged in cages. You're probably aware what a zoo is. It was all right apart from the gorilla enclosure. There was a really big gorilla just sort of sitting there, looking so sad. For a moment, I thought it was like a model because it was so still. And then it moves. Then I thought it's a man dressed up as a gorilla. I thought they probably wouldn't do that. That might be a nicer way of doing the gorillas, though, wouldn't it? Just as unemployed actors pretending. And he just looked so angry. I might have watched too much Planet of the Apes, but it felt like it's just a little change in DNA, and he'd be walking around, wouldn't he? And looking at stuff. It feels wrong. It feels like a prison when it's a great ape, but it's good. Go and see it. But when the apes do take over, I think the London Zoo will still be open. Obviously, all human beings will be in all the cages, but there'll be an exhibit about the awful way animals were treated, like a sort of memorial thing, won't they? And then they'll go in the restaurant and they go, this is where the human beings came and who claimed they liked animals and ate animals. It's sort of weird that you eat a beef burger in a zoo. It's sort of. I did it. I don't care. So it's fine. We've got some VIPs in today. We've got Victoria Letts. Where I give us a whoop, Victoria. There she is. Should have a special hat, but you know she's chosen not to wear it. And Colin Anderton is in there. He's got his hat on. There's also a replacement VIP from someone who was meant to be the other week and didn't turn up. Who sent a proxy called Tom Sawyer, which doesn't seem very likely to me. But where are you, Tom? No, he's there. That's him there. I don't know if that is. Maybe he didn't turn. Maybe that's the joke. He's just going to keep not turning up. Tom Sawyer. That's a made-up character. We've got a double help. In the next two, we've got a double helping of S&M for the next 2 weeks. Because it's the initials of the guests. Our guest this week is probably best known for her work as a runner on the TV show Our Friends in the North. That is why we're... That's the most high-profile thing she's been involved in. Will you please welcome Sarah Millican, ladies and gentlemen? Sarah Millican. We just met. I just told him we had a Chinese together.
That was quite a nice introduction. I was bracing myself because it's normally worse.
Well, you know, that's quite bad. I didn't know that you were
it
a runner.
Wasn't.
When, what were you? That's pretty. It is impressive. You were a
it's
runner.
It's not impressive.
It is. I'm impressed.
I don't run.
You met.
I was a walker.
You met the people
at best.
From our friends in the north in real life.
Yeah.
Was it Christopher Eccleston?
Yeah, Daniel Craig.
Oh yeah.
Mark Strong, Gina McKee.
It's
Peter
pretty
Bowen.
Good, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was quite chock full,
yeah.
Really, of awesome people.
Do they remember you from being in that when you meet them?
I've
now?
Not mentioned it. Do you remember I got you a sandwich once?
No.
But it was a really, it was a good thing to be on. It was really.
Which of them was the biggest prick out of all the people in Our Friends and All?
They were all really nice.
Really?
Daniel Craig had an excellent bum in jeans. That was one of my main memories. I used to wait for him to walk ahead so I could see his bum in jeans. I wasn't really, you say runner, I think that was slightly higher level than I was.
Right.
Because I sort of volunteered my services. That sounds terrible, I've realised. I sucked them all off. No. I didn't get paid. I wasn't a paid runner because I couldn't drive. So they said they couldn't give me the job because I couldn't drive, but they could, like, I could kind of hang out and do some stuff for free.
Right.
And I just really wanted the expert because I wanted to be a, I wanted to work in film. I wanted to be like a film director at the time.
Yeah.
And I thought it would be a really good experience, and it was. It was.
We need a runner for As It Occurs to Me if you want to hang out.
Is it paid?
We'll give you 20 quid and a sandwich.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Pret a manger.
Do I have to get my own sandwich?
You'll have to go and get the sandwiches, but we'll give you the money. That's your job, that you're the runner. That's what.
No, but so at least if I'm getting all the sandwiches, somebody could get my bloody sandwich.
That's how it works. Do you want me to go out and get you a sandwich?
Yes, please.
Okay, I will. So it's nice to have you back.
It's nice to be back.
I think everyone agrees. We talked four times, including Edinburgh, and everyone says it's 4-0 to me so far. That is what everyone has agreed. So we'll see. I'm going to take it a bit easy on you this time, give you a chance.
I always win. You know I always win. We'll see what happens this time, though.
Yeah.
Because we socialised beforehand.
We did.
You didn't embarrass me massively in my introduction.
No.
So I think you might be softening.
I've matured.
Have you really?
Yeah, I'm very mature now.
Because you had a baby on the way last time.
That's right, yes. I was worried about... Last time I was worried that I would die before my baby... I saw my baby's face. Now I've seen it enough. I'm ready to go. To be fair, she is going to kill me as well.
She's going to kill you how?
Well, because she's very tiring. I'm very old and she gets up early.
Oh, she's going to... So in kind of a long, like a low-level way, she's going to kill you. It's not going to be...
Well, if
like,
she does
knifey,
murder me,
knifey.
If she does do that, that would be a nice little bit to take out of the podcast and make into some kind of GIF. Going to kill me.
Yeah. I mean, you wouldn't. I'd be able to use it. We could all use it. You wouldn't be able to use it because you'd be dead.
I would be dead, unfortunately. But no.
What are you scared of now, then?
Everything. No, everything's terrifying. The world's terrifying.
It is.
Oh, every.
And you brought a new one in, you idiot.
I know.
You've got a new person
know,
into this
awful.
Terrible, terrible world.
We've got a president who, I mean, the American president of the many bad things. If he's still alive, which last time I printed, he wouldn't be by the time we're talking. So, but apologies if Donald Trump is dead.
Because you weren't involved.
No, I don't think it, because this is going out in January or February. I don't think he'll make it that long.
You don't, That's quite a long way off, isn't
it? Is,
it?
Yeah.
It's quite a long way off.
So if it's Pence instead, it's kind of worse. But Donald Trump doesn't believe, he thinks that... climate change is a hoax created by the Chinese. So that's quite worrying. That's, out of all the things, that's quite a worrying thing. He's not going to do any of the Paris agreements or stuff. So my daughter will be living underwater in 50 years' time.
Oh, like in a under the sea?
Yeah.
Like in that sort of...
Well, it's nearly my daughter living underwater to the slaughter.
Yeah, I finally got it when you did the slaughter, sorry. So you're worried about everything?
Yeah, I always worried about everything anyway.
So do you hark back to simpler times when you were just worried that you wouldn't see your baby's face before you died?
Yeah, I sort of do. That was a nice time.
The good old days.
It was the good old days. But I've seen her face. She's got a nice face, so I'm glad I did see it. But you know, whenever
you sound like you've just seen it the once.
Whenever...
I feel like you might be a terrible father.
The problem is, like, either... I die before her, which is, and I don't see how her life turns out, which is terrible. Or she dies before I do, which is even worse. And those are the only two options. So it's quite hard to enjoy life anymore because it's just knowing that's how it's going to go is awful.
Is this the first time you've realised? realise that that's how life works?
No, but it's you suddenly
realise.
It
took you to have a baby before you realised that at some point people die.
I want
to
see how it turns out for her, and it's, I'm not going to, am I?
But you know, it's not a sitcom. Wait, how it turns out for her. I think she'll get quite a few series. She'll be fine.
Yeah, I hope so. So that's my changes. You got some, any more pets?
Since I've got a dog since the last
have
time.
You?
Yeah, I've got a dog. I've got a schnoodle. Thanks. It's not a joke in itself, but thanks for laughing at the type of dog I have. Feels like that might be racist, whatever you laughed at there. It's a schnauzer and a poodle combined. Mm. And he is he's a little cheeky chappy. He's adorable. He's a rescue. Yeah. So it means any behaviour that is sort of bad, we just blame it. Like, oh, he's a rescue. And they go, oh, that's okay that he's shit in my hand. People excuse anything if you say rescue. Yeah. It's almost a shame you can't say it about people. He's a rescue. So he's got a poly foot at the minute because he pulled one of his claws out in the garden. Intentionally, he caught it on the thing. Yeah. And so he's got a little boot on at the minute. And it's really bad that I shouldn't laugh. But it is hilarious because he's running with one sort of clumpy foot. And then most of the time he lifts it up in the air. When he sleeps, it's pointed up and it looks like he's doing a Nazi salute. I mean, that might be his beliefs. I hope not, but it might be his beliefs. I've not questioned him on it.
The dog claws grow back or if it's been stuck back on again?
He pulled out the whole nail, the nail bed. Sorry, everyone. And it was at midnight on a Saturday night. Right. My vet is amazing. Yeah. They were like, we'll see you there in 15 minutes. Thanks. Yeah, so he's all right now. He's been off his tits on painkillers. It won't grow back, no. He's not like a Terminator.
Well, if you pull someone's nail out, they grow back, don't they?
Not if it's the nail bed as well. The vet did say, is it his left foreleg? And I was just racking my brains because we call it an arm. Because it's at the front. Arms, legs, hands, feet, nails. He's on the mend, but he's been off his tits on painkillers. So that's been quite entertaining.
My cat died, so, you know, thanks for bringing up pets.
Was your cat waiting to see your baby's face?
He was. I think she was a bit put out that a baby arrived.
And then just killed herself.
I don't think the two things are connected, but, you know, she's been alive for a while, my daughter, so...
Can you only look after one thing at a time, is that...
No, it's partly that. I've got another cat. The other cat's doing okay.
Oh, okay, because you had two.
You've not replaced one really quickly. No, we've only got one.
How is the other one managing?
Well, he seems all right. He is very stupid. They're rescue cats also. But they were very inbred. That was that someone had tried to breed a beautiful black and a beautiful white cat. And they got they're nice looking cats, but one of them, the white cat, is very stupid and deaf. And the black cat had a heart condition.
Oh.
So
you got the stupid one left?
The stupid one is left, which is, you know, if I had to choose, I would have killed him. If I'd had to watch one of them be put down. I'd prefer to watch
it's
him be put down.
Your choice of vocabulary that you didn't say, if I chose for one of them to die, you said, I would kill him. Implying that you did kill the other
you
one.
You sort of do kill them because, you know, you have
no,
to...
No, you don't, Richard.
You do. You give the order to go...
The
man
order?
Go, they inject them with a...
Putting it out of its misery. Yeah. Yeah, but you don't give an order for a man or a woman with a needle.
Goes, are you ready? Do the killing now. That's what I said. Kill it now. Why are you crying, Katie? It's fine. Kill it.
You got another cat, haven't you? I'm very sad about your cat.
I think he's doing all right.
You've got good names, your cats. What are they called?
Well, Smithers is the living one. And Lion-O is the...
That's sad.
Named after the Thundercat.
Well, I'm glad you said that because I couldn't think of anything other than Thundercat that it might be named after. Yeah. All
or
of the other Lion-Os, you know.
Could be their floor, like the kitchen Lion-O. Well, I did just call it Lion-O in the end. Just became Lion-O. I'm over. I'm getting on with it. But, you know, let's not talk about cats. But let's talk about gorillas because I met a gorilla this week, and you fancy gorillas.
I fancied one. I don't fancy all of them.
Well, okay, that's much better than
it is. I'm selective.
There was one very
in Bristol Zoo.
Oh yeah.
And it just sort of gave me the eye.
Okay.
And I properly fancied it, and then I thought, I bet he's good at sex. Don't you think? And I like a hairy man.
Yeah.
I sort of ticked a few boxes.
Gorillas have quite small penises because they're. That's one of the things I learned doing talking cock. It's not something.
That they've got small penises.
They've got small penises comparatively, yeah.
To them or compared to you?
Well, every animal compared to me. Just, the blue whale is looking at me going, I wish I had that. Wish I was packing something like that. But yeah, they're kind of. Because it's something to do with fidelity and how faithful things are, how big their testicles are and how big their genitals
are. Oh, really?
Are, yeah.
I should read your book, shouldn't I?
I think the gorilla, I might be getting this wrong, but I think gorillas are quite a faithful animal.
So therefore it can have a...
It can have a rubbish
penis. So does that
penis.
Mean that you're not faithful?
Yeah, that means I'm unfaithful.
Yeah,
I've got
know.
Enormous testicles.
Do you think that's a good thing for a woman to hear?
Do you know, it's full of potential more beautiful babies.
I feel like he's offering, do you? Actually, you might be able to help me.
Yeah,
I like
okay.
wearing... No, not like that. Not like that. I put my jeans on today, and I'm slightly worried what this bit's for. So they fit around the top, and they fit on the legs-ish, but I don't... Is this for my massive testicles that I should have? I don't know what the... Am I missing something? Am I supposed to have bigger labia than what I have? I mean, there are bits of me that are too big, but it would be good to know that something was too small. I'm confused.
I remember at school being on a school bus, a trip to France, and I was wearing some brown sort of chino-y things.
Nice.
And they had that coming up like that, and I was very embarrassed because it was...
Did it look like you had an erection?
Well, it looks like you had an erection, or it looks like you've got no genitals. Either this, the space where your genitals are meant to be
was empty.
Yeah.
Just vacated.
Yeah.
So maybe what you said before was all rubbish then.
All right, do you want me to get it out and prove it? Is that what you want?
I was going
to
say all bollocks, but that doesn't help.
That bit's bollocks down there. I'm touching them now.
Oh, no, I don't want to look.
I am
touching
the testicles.
Shield your eyes.
And the
penis
is more in this area. And then look, I've got all that sort of there. Look,
what's it for? Does anybody know what it's for? Does anybody in the room... Just for the podcast listeners, Richard was pretending to wank his substantial, apparently, cock.
Pretending? Oh, was I pretending? The perfect crime. It was the
You seem to me like a man who couldn't stop.
Stop wanking?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Once you started. You can't just have a little...
Even after I've finished.
Oh. Can't stop.
Let's keep going until the next one comes along. In the old days, I was a younger man. Now, you know, it takes a little while to
get, have a breather.
You have to take a run up to get there. And then once it's over, it's thanks very much. See you in 24 hours.
See you tomorrow. See you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow for more of my penis.
Have you got any questions?
Yeah, I have. I thought we should talk about... Just getting the flirting out and just start with
this is what he thinks is flirting. It's hilarious. Oh, is it a good job he's married that he's not? He's off the market now, so that all the women are safe.
You grew up in South Shields.
I did.
Which did you know? In South Shields, William Woodhave was from South Shields, and he was potentially the inventor of the lifeboat. Though there is some debate about whether he actually was.
Is there some debate?
Yeah. Someone else claims that they're the inventor of the lifeboat.
Is it you?
No.
No?
William Woodhave, that's his name, William Woodhave.
Yeah, there's a boat.
Is there?
Yeah, and there was Woodhave House was like some kind of benefits agency building as well, I think. Can't really remember. It's a long time ago since...
Well, he maybe invented the lifeboat. Did you know...
Is that what it says on the plaque? Maybe he invented the lifeboat.
Possibly he did. Do you remember the trolley bus that used to be in South Shields?
No. 41, love. Not as old as you.
It stopped in 64.
Oh, thanks. You just added 11 years onto my life.
Did your family ever ride on the trolley bus?
They don't talk about it now, like in wistful ways.
No. What is a trolley bus?
I think it's like a bigger version of a trolley that you'd get in Asda.
Okay.
So it goes up and down the street, but everybody has to just climb up the side and then sit in like a big open space together.
Yeah.
There's a bit at the front as well for the babies.
Okay.
And then a giant man or woman pushes you along the street.
I can see why that went out of fashion.
Yeah, it's ridiculous, really.
Good. Did you like South Shields? Is it all right?
Yeah, it is nice. It's on the seafront, which is nice.
I didn't know your dad worked. He wasn't a miner, but he worked in the mines.
Electrical engineering, yeah. Mines, yeah.
And so you were the miners' strike hit.
Yeah,
your
I was
family.
Nine.
Yeah. So you were getting extra food at dinner time at school and stuff like this.
Yeah, we got there was only two girls in my year who had dads and who worked down the pit, so we always got, because I was on free, we owned free dinners, and we got extra dinners because it was sort of unlikely that we get much when we got home because there wasn't any money. So, but we also got cuddles off dinner ladies, which, yeah, it was sort of worth the minor strike, to be honest. No, it was, dinner ladies have always got cracking arms, haven't they? Good, it's off, you know, all the mashing, isn't it? And they usually got good arms, so they must swap it over because you don't want to have one big mashing arm, do you? And then one really skinny arm. So they must be like ambidextrous on the mashing, I think. I've thought about this too much, I think. But yeah, I used to get cuddles off the dinner ladies because they just felt sad for us. We were having, like, when you're a kid, it's like, we had some fun. It wasn't all sort of miserable. I think it kind of brings the family closer together and all of those things. And we did, what else did we do? We went on holiday. I went on the only holiday I'd ever had without my sister. My sister's older, so obviously she was always bloody there. And but then my sister was taken away with some of, there was a bit of money. The sort of French miners paid for some of the British kids to go over and have a holiday. And my sister was old enough for her name to be put in the hat, and then she got to go. So she went skiing. And I was too young, so I was only nine. So I went to Carlisle, camping, what the fuck, with my mum and dad, and had probably one of the best holidays of my life because I had their sole attention, which is all I really want, is people's attention. there was some fun in amongst all of the kind of sad.
Yeah. It's all kind of been covered up, though, and there was a thing in the paper today about how all the Conservatives aren't allowing the papers saying what they actually were doing to, you know, the Times Plus. It's about 30 years ago, isn't it?
Yes. Oh, God, it's 32 years ago.
So I think there comes a point where those papers are meant to be released, but they're not releasing them because they'd have to admit that they were all evil and doing
them. Well, I kind of remember it as a nine-year-old, so I remember stuff that happened to me rather than what was actually happening to my parents. And like the various sort of supermarkets around decided they were going to give us some free stuff.
Yeah.
So the I think it was Presto or maybe Hinton's at the time, which then became Safeway all the way along. They gave us sort of tins and stuff that were bashed, and also bread and things at the end of day, sort of pastries and things. And then Marks and Spencer's decided to join in, and they gave us 13 trays of avocados. And not a single miner knew what the fuck they were supposed to do with them. And we were like, do we eat the skin? Do we peel them? What do we do? Do they go in soup? I have no idea. So that was kind of, they wanted to help, but they didn't. That's a lot of space. I think they were over-ordering on their avocados to have 13 trays spare.
Yeah. Was there a big market for, even in the affluent parts of South Shields, for avocados
I think they might have even turned them down. Nobody knew what to do with them.
I remember avocados arriving, you know, so I'm old enough to
remember them arriving.
I remember a time before. I remember the ship coming in.
Did you wave it in? The avocados have arrived. What are they? I don't know.
Whenever it was about that time, avocados suddenly started appearing in shops. And that was in a sophisticated middle class dinner party, was half an avocado with some vinaigrette in it.
Really?
Yeah, that was what you did with them, so I could have come and showed you what you did with them.
You could have done. Yeah. That would have been... How old were you in 1984?
I was about 17.
You would have been... Yeah, you could have come and been the one that showed us how to use avocados.
I could have helped out the miners' strike.
I mean, when you say helped out the miners' strike, I'm not sure that would have helped that much, but we would have eaten more, which was nice.
So you were on this morning?
I was on this morning.
Who is best at interviewing me or Philip Schofield?
An interviewing.
Yeah.
Well, I get longer on this.
Yeah.
I got 8 minutes on this morning.
Did Philip Schofield ask you about?
We talked about my dog, and we talked about messes I make in hotels. We talked about my DVD, which is out today.
I'll tell him about messes. Get Philip Schofield on, I'll tell him about messes I've made in hotels.
I told you this. I was once sitting up in a hotel bed in a Premier Inn. Oh, shouldn't say that, should I?
Yeah, you can. Yeah, doesn't matter. Yeah.
And
I mean, they're not going to pay us for it, but you know.
Okay. In a relatively budget hotel that's kind of purple.
Say what you like.
Lenny Henry, Premier Inn, And I sat up, and as I pulled my head away from the headboard, some of my hair stuck to the headboard. I know. I just kept thinking it was jam. They don't allow jam in the rooms. It wasn't jam. It was spaff, wasn't it? But I just let it dry, brushed it out, off we go. Do you not know that's what you know? You don't know that's what you do. Okay.
I mean, you sort of wonder with hotel, because occasionally you see hotels that aren't clean, or a bit of it isn't clean. Yeah. I discussed recently the bogey on the shower curtain of the Travelodge in Cambridge. But then it makes you wonder, well, you know, you find something under the bed sometimes. And so, like, if you have to sort of forget it, don't you? You have to blank out what might be on the...
I never take one of those sort of CSI UV lights. No. Because there's just... It's up the walls. I had a friend who used to put a pube on the bath when he first went into a hotel room and then go and complain and then he'd get it cheaper. They never did a DNA test to find out whose pube it was. It's quite a good tip, that, isn't it? It's quite a good tip. I was once in a hotel with my now husband and there was old man pants under the bed.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And then old man in the wardrobe.
Yeah, there was an old man in the pants.
Where are my pants?
I can't
leave the room. I've got my pants.
So your second marriage is still going all right?
Yeah, how's yours?
Still, yeah, good. Well, I'm on my first, so you know, it's. I've never been
I
divorced.
I managed to find two people who wanted to marry me.
Yeah,
that's how I turn. I make it positive.
I won't gloat too much because I'm hanging on by my fingernails at the moment. But it's. What's it like being married to a comedian? It must be fun. You must be laughing all the time. You're married to another comedian. It must be hilarious.
Has anybody ever asked your wife that?
Yeah. Nope.
It's fun. We are funny.
Yeah.
Same as you and yours, though. You're, it's the same situation.
No, we're not.
Are you not funny?
She doesn't find me funny at all.
Does she not? No. What does she find you?
I don't know what she likes in me at all.
She sometimes doesn't even find you. She just leaves you.
I don't know what she... I think she's just perverted and fancies me for some reason. But, you know, she just... You know, it's difficult when you're with someone a lot.
It'll be your massive bollocks that you like.
It might be the bollocks. How
women
she
love
know?
A big pair of balls, don't we, girls? Somebody clapped her. Was that just the sound of bollocks clapping together?
It's like mine are so big, if you were teabagging me, it's like...
If I was teabagging like you...
And when they go like that round your chin, they'll be castanets banging against each other.
What a lovely image. I never really liked castanets.
I think she's fine. I don't know why my wife's married to me, but...
You don't need to know. No. Never ask why, Richard.
I think you just stick with it, don't you, as well? I think, you didn't the first time, but once you...
No, I did. He was the one that fucked up.
That's fair enough. It's, you know, you sort of think it's been more hassle than it's worth to go, wouldn't it?
Well, I gave it another go.
Yeah.
I think this one's more worth it, to be honest. My mum did say when she first met my husband now, she said, oh, try to hold on to this one. And I am, I'm holding on, because he's a good one.
He is a good one.
He's a really good one this time. Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he'll do all right. Good, I'm glad you're still all right together. Keep me up to date. If we just let me, if it's starting to go on the slide, let me know.
Okay.
You know, I'm happy to step in, that's what I'm saying.
Oh, it's nice to have a backup, isn't it?
If mine's going downhill, you know, just like if it's speeding
if I could just
jump across.
If we're both going downhill at the same time, then we could coincide.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
That'd be nice.
Maybe I'll have to start learning to love castanets.
I'll ask you some new emergency questions. I asked you some backstage.
You did?
My computer keeps on going off.
Is this your new DVD?
That's my new DVD, Happy Now, yeah.
Yeah,
I don't... Mine don't go in the shops like yours do, though, so that's...
Do you want me to put one in? I could put one in HMV for you.
Okay, nice. Yeah, put in HMV, because you can sell them for a lot in there. We can put £25 in HMV, can't you?
They're not £25. £25.
I know, but that's in HMV. They mark it up, don't they? Because they can't.
Yeah, but they're not. Nobody you would go into buy a, it for
you go,
25.
You go into HMV to see what's there, and then you buy it online, don't you? That's the basic.
Yeah.
It's a little window shop for the internet.
Saves you going outside.
Yeah.
I know you are outside. You could look on the HMV website and then go and buy it somewhere else. That doesn't work. But that's just.
If you had to live out the rest of your life being either Toby Young or Dom Jolly. Would you just kill yourself now?
I've not met either of them, to be fair.
Yeah.
God, that's really hard. Yeah. What methods do I have to kill myself? What options are there? The usual options.
Just the usual options. Let's not go into those.
I don't know.
No.
What was that? Kill death by testicle, did somebody say?
It's a tough choice.
Don't, maybe Dom Jolly?
Yeah, he'd kill you. Yeah. Does, does sex with the robot count as cheating if the robot is an exact copy of your partner in looks and personality?
Well, why are you bothering then?
Well, because a compliment to your partner. It's like
your
viewer away.
Does do different things to your partner?
No, it can be the same.
Just the same things to your partner?
But your partner goes away and you go, while you're away, I'll make love to an exact copy of you. It's kind of
romantic.
So
your partner knows?
Yeah. You tell
your partner's
them about
given
it.
Consent?
Yeah.
Then that's fine. That's not cheating.
Would it be a bit of a waste of having a sex robot?
Yeah. Because it should definitely be somebody else who does dirtier things.
Okay. And what if the sex...
Shouldn't it? Oh, I'd like you to do less than my partner. Please just cuddle me. What? I think robot cuddles would be really rubbish because they're cold, aren't they?
They'd be warm.
Could you cover one in, like, fuzzy felt? If you could cover a robot in fuzzy felt, that would be worth spooning.
The new ones promise there's some coming out next year that costs £12,000. I haven't researched this. From a company called Abyss.
But did you just get a prostitute?
Well, £12,000 and they have vibrating warm genitalia.
Warm, but the rest of them is cold. He's doing just for the podcast listeners. He's doing kind of a hand vagina thing.
Like a sea anemone.
That. So warm, vibrating, genitalia. Yeah. But the rest of them is cold.
And the robot can talk. It's like, oh yeah. Is
the robot programmed to always enjoy
it? I don't know.
Or can the robot sometimes go, oh no, I've got another episode of this box set. Fuck off.
Well, for me,
£12,000 for warm, vibrating genitalia.
Well, I think what I enjoyed when I was single was the chase. It was the seduction rather than necessarily... it was like, you know...
Do you want to chase a robot?
It was like, I think if the robot's definitely going to have sex with you, I don't think that's that exciting a prospect. So I think you need a robot that you can chat up and then it might just go, no, mate, sorry. Okay, I spent £12,000, should have been better chatting me up.
Yeah,
not interested.
I think you might just need a robot that can run... And then you could just run after it.
Yeah.
That's just a very basic definition of the word chase.
Okay. What about the robot that looks exactly like your partner? What if it's an exact copy of them, what they looked like 10 years ago when you first met them?
Oh, no, because then I would feel really old and fat. Because I like that we're aging and putting weight on at the same speed.
Oh, so it would make you feel bad to see them being young.
I'd feel like a fucking house.
Yeah.
If they were, like, young and sort of slim and...
Yeah.
No,
I don't think
no.
Gary was ever that slim.
I don't remember you ever being that fucking slim. But we all had Stuart Lee to compare him to. We don't anymore, so we don't know how fat he is.
I've seen him, you should get him back. I'd be looking pretty good.
I think I wouldn't want somebody who was in young. Who wants to have sex with somebody? Oh, you do, don't you? Look at your face. I like men in their... I like men in their 40s. You're in your 40s. I didn't
only
mean
just.
All men. Oh, that's all right then. I wouldn't want to go out with a 30-year-old. Oh, no. So, no, I'll just stick to the one I've got. Is that an option?
Yeah, that's all right. That's allowed. I'll ask you this question. This is a popular new question. If you had to do a human centipede with two other people...
This doesn't happen on this morning.
You are in the middle of the centipede...
Well,
which two
you've got
people?
To get the maximum benefit.
Yeah, which two people? So who would be for you and who would be behind you?
So whose shit would I eat?
Yes.
And who would I like to eat my shit?
Yeah. You've got the basic gist of the question.
Well, I've not seen the film, but I've read the reviews. I think I'd like an old school bully to eat my shit. Is that right?
Yeah.
And whose shit would I eat? Philip Schofield.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
I've loved him since I was 13.
Yeah.
I don't think there's anything he'd do that wouldn't make me love him.
I think his poo might be quite fruity still as well.
Fruity? Do you think he'd eat quite healthily?
Yeah, I think he might come out quite, fruity. Slightly decaying fruit.
Yeah. My school bully would have a horrible time because I've got terrible IBS. It's a good job she'd be sewn on because she wouldn't get to it quick enough otherwise. You're welcome.
Have you ever encountered your school bully or have you looked her up on Facebook or anything?
No.
No.
I do talk about her in my new DVD that's out now. No, I haven't. There's no need. I didn't like her then, so I'm not going to like her now.
It's sort of weird, though, with the bully. The bully thing, I think, is because everyone was bullied and probably everyone bullied someone without really realising.
Do you think everybody was bullied?
I think probably
is it just because you're taking it from your audience?
It might be from my audience.
No offence. I think, but in some gang,
in some situation, in your, you know, I was watching The Secret Life of 4-year-olds the other day, and like kids are just horrible to each other, and then nice to each other, and then horrible to each other. So it depends how sensitive you are.
I don't think I bullied anybody.
No.
Did anybody here think that they didn't bully anybody?
Yes. I reckon.
One person. Thank
you.
You and I are the best people in the room, Flower. Lord, so you all bullied somebody?
I think you probably did. I mean, I think most people to some extent, and you might not necessarily, your bully might not remember that you bullied her. Do you think she would? Do you think she'll remember
that you bullied her? I think you're absolutely right in that. I think that people will say, oh, you behaved this way and you didn't think it was bad at the time or so bad at the time. No, I get that. Yeah. I hope I didn't bully anybody. I certainly didn't intend to.
No.
I mean, I do it now, just mostly you, though.
It's mainly me.
But it's an asshole.
I think you do, because... But it's so weird as a kid, but as an adult as well, people are trying to get into cliques and they're trying to be friends. You know, you try to be friends with people, so if you see weakness... I think as kids, they see weakness, and then, you know, they'll pounce on that. So I, you know, and as a comedian, you can go two ways. You're either protecting yourself, or you can sometimes be a bit cruel to somebody else in order to distance yourself from them. Donald Trump works on that kind of deflection, and he's a bully. He works on that deflection thing. He'll basically, whatever the other... So, like, this week in the Hamilton thing, casting where Pence was booed by some of the audience of Hamilton, and Trump has the audacity to go, this is very bad behaviour, after all this stuff's come out about him, you know, doing an impression of a disabled person.
Yeah. But also he implied that it was the cast that had behaved badly, and the cast had been very gracious, from what I read, anyway.
That's typical kind of bully behaviour, go, this is your fault, and to deflect off, to go, these other people are doing this stuff, not me. It's a lot of adults use that deflection technique, pointing out the things that are within them. They try to pretend other people have them rather than them.
I don't think I'm as complicated as that.
No, okay. I'm not saying you. Your new DVD, it's called Outsider.
It is.
And why is it called an outsider in terms of in what?
Well, firstly, because I'm outside more.
Right.
The most basic way. It's really smart. Because I used to be, I never liked being out, I wasn't outdoorsy at all, I was very indoorsy, I would rather be in with a book than out sort of walking. And then when we moved to the countryside, I sort of realised why people like going outside, because it's really pretty.
Yeah.
And also because I've got a dog and he needs emptying a lot. God. We just tried not feeding him, because we thought that would be easier. So we get to go on nice walks with him, and I just realised that, quite a lot of the sort of the first bit is about being outside and just enjoying being outside. And then there's stuff about being an outsider. And I think most comics, I think you would probably agree that we're all a bit on the periphery.
Yep.
So because everybody else was going to a party and we weren't invited, and then we eventually write stand-up about how we weren't invited to the party. So I think, it's kind of both sides of what an outsider is.
Sure.
I've not made it sound hilarious, if you ask. There's jokes.
So it's
There's
mainly just
about
you walking around outside.
Picking up
shits.
Yeah, picking up shits outside while crying about being an outsider at school. That's the gist.
Good. I'm going to buy a copy of it.
You don't need to. I'll do swapsies if you like.
Okay,
I'd like to see your last one. Because a lot of the other ones were quite sort of grumpy. And then it's nice that this one's sort of happy.
Yeah. We'll see.
Yeah, I haven't seen this one. I didn't get to see it on tour, so I'll do swapsies with you.
Oh, that's nice. That's good. I'm meant to be moving to the countryside. I just found out today, I'm very angry.
Yeah.
I just found out today the people who were buying the house have just pulled out of us buying the house, which is very, very annoying. I'm amazed I'm holding it together.
Did they Google you?
No, she did when I was looking around the house, she did. She said, I think I know you from somewhere. I said, yeah, I'm a comedian. And then as I was looking around the second time, she Googled me and said, oh, I found you on the internet. She didn't seem
you
to mind.
You were Stuart Lee's little friend.
I don't know. They've got a reason why, and I'm not sure. But it's annoying because
it's frustrating.
We were progressing to the point that I was cancelling things in, you know, in our house, and it was nearly happening. And
but so also,
then,
you
and then you're ready. You've imagined yourself in that house, and then it's gone.
Yeah, but then you'll get, because that happened to me.
Yeah,
it's not a brilliant story, but it happened to me, and then I had so I got to the point where I'd paid for the survey and all of that sort of stuff, and then I walked away because they were starting to try and milk me dry. So I walked away, and then I was gutted. But then, like a month later, I started looking again, and I found the place I've got now, which is much nicer. So you will find somewhere nicer.
What if that's time? Find somewhere that isn't as nice.
Don't buy that one.
Okay.
You don't have to buy the first house you see. Oh, just keep looking, and you'll find another one that you both like.
But yeah, we.
It's lovely.
Well, hopefully it was sort of interesting because we're going to be like in a little country, in a little village, and you don't know whether you know. We don't know whether I was. I'd kind of got my head around doing that, and I was quite looking forward to having a garden.
You can do that again. You can
I'm sure we will.
Not, that's not the only house that's got a garden.
Yeah, my wife's very picky though. A very choosy
she's not,
woman. That's
I
why
mean, she's not that choosy. Yeah, but she is on houses because she's not elsewhere. That's mean. She's lovely. She's got good taste in most things. You'll find. No, you will, and it'll be better.
Annoying, though. I'm never going. We've been doing it for 2 years. I'm fed up of Shepherd's
Bush.
Yeah.
Well, where you are now is not a nice place, but you will. No, I don't mean geographically. I mean, it's yeah. You'll find somewhere better. Yeah. Won't you find somewhere better? Yeah, has this happened to anybody else?
No.
Yeah. No. No. No.
If I, yes, you know, but it's going on so long, I might not, you know, I'll be too old to enjoy it. But the other day, interesting.
Oh my God, you're
you
so
know,
fucking dramatic.
In, this is an interesting.
How old are you?
It's an interesting.
Are you
49? 49 years old. Oh, that's very old.
You've here's got a good 2 or 3 years left in you.
You'll see. You'll see.
You're massive bollocks.
Here's an interesting. Like, I've had all sorts of things happen in my house which, you know, won't help me sell it. Like someone did a shit in the front by the gate. I had to,
still there.
No, well, I had to clear up a human shit.
How do you know it was human?
You could tell.
Did
oh, you can
watch,
tell, my
did
friend.
Did you watch them do it?
Was it
not
definitely
just a massive
a human
dog?
Pig. It was no. It was definitely. It was the way it fell on the wall was enough.
On the wall?
Yeah, they pooed like on the wall in my.
And but then the other thing. Did
just
stick
left it
to
there,
the wall?
Just. We don't need to know about the massive poo. This is another moral dilemma from Shepherd's Bush. Our house goes. There's a basement, so and outside the basement there's like a little sort of shed thing. Like so, you go down. If you're on the outside, you go down, and there's a little thing where there's the drains are basically right.
Okay.
So there's a little door. You open up the mm-hmm. drains. And there's a tiny little room, and a homeless person slept in there the other day. My wife came down early in the morning, and then they saw this woman looking in the window, and then this woman ran away. God, that's weird, isn't it? But then, do I lock that door and not let the homeless woman sleep in my house? Or do I... Or do I allow her to sleep in a fucking drain? Or do I say,
do I say,
come and live in my house? Because this is awful.
When you buy your new house, could you leave her... old house.
Yeah, I could give it the whole
house.
Then
she could have the rest of the house.
I could do up the drains. I could do up the drain.
Do up. Was it her that did the shit?
No, well, I don't think it was. It was because that was a while ago. But then that's the other thing, isn't it? What's she doing? It's fine. And then just think, well, then where she's going to... I mean, she's pooing in the drain, probably. As long as she lifts the cover... If she lifts the cover off... But then what, she falls down the drain when she's doing
the
poo?
How big is the drain that
it's a proper drain. She could fall
into... Oh, it's not just like a drain.
No, it's like the manhole cover there. So you can lift up the manhole cover, poo
squat
in that.
Over the edge.
Then she falls in. I don't go down there, ever. I'd come down trying to sell the house. Someone's looking around. There's a skeleton of a homeless person. A pooing skeleton.
How many years is it going to be before you move? That she's turned
time.
Into a skeleton.
It could be a long time.
And also, if she squatted on the edge of the man, like lifted the man, that's the best position you're supposed to be in to do a poo, isn't
it? Yeah.
Like in a sort of squatting position.
Yeah.
So she'll have cracking bowels. Okay. And that's a nice thing. You
what
can
would
give
you
someone...
do? Would you let the homeless person carry on living in that room? Would you lock it so they couldn't get in again? Or would you let them live in your house with you and your wife and your child?
I wouldn't do the last one, because they're a stranger. That's not because they're homeless, because they're a stranger.
Yeah.
I would probably leave it unlocked.
Would you?
Yeah, because what harm is she doing?
She might go, you know, might go feral, start attacking. Like she might be like a trot. It's like I have to walk
I'm not
over.
Sure
a,
what you think
I'd
about
have to
homeless
walk.
People, but they're not wild.
I'd have to walk along the path every day. She'd be out there going, rah!
Maybe
be like a troll. Answer me this question, or you can't come in.
But this is the kind of questions you ask me. Could you befriend her?
She hasn't come back again, so it's all right. She got my maybe wife scared her away.
Maybe she Googled you.
She might be giving me a review on some Airbnb or something. Very poor drain. I mean, that's awful. That's so awful that someone...
But my bowels are great.
It's so awful to think about
that's
someone...
That's so sad.
She pulled in some, like, leaves and some, like, branches and
you
stuff.
Just put a blanket in there.
Well, I don't really want her to sleep in there either.
I don't know what the answer is.
No, it's weird, isn't it?
Yeah. Sorry I didn't make homeless people funny for you.
No, it didn't. It wasn't meant to be funny. It was meant to be it was meant to be very much a,
like
a
moral
dilemma. Yeah. So I've looked you up on YouGov. There's a YouGov. Before I looked you up on Dirty Britcom Confessions, but nothing has changed there.
Oh, I've not got any new ones.
I don't think so, no.
Oh, I feel sad.
But I don't think they're taking new. Not that I've put loads in and they've been rejected, but I don't think they're all about you. There's a YouGov thing which gives you your typical fan of you can put your name, and then it's done a survey of your fans, and actually what it is it'll tell you the thing that makes them different than everyone else.
But your this is nice.
My fans watch less than 1 hour of television a week.
Really?
Yeah. Your fans watch 31 to 35 hours of television.
My fans are the same as me.
Their favourite food, usually this is something quite weird, their favourite food is chocolate cake.
I could tell you all of this. You don't need to look this up.
And their job, they all work in translation and interpreting. Did you know that?
All of them?
Yeah.
It feels like that's quite niche.
Yeah.
Why do yours only watch less than 1 hour
I
of television?
I can't believe that's true. But
is
quite
it because
a
they're consuming all of the other things that you've made for them, all of the podcasts and DVDs?
There's no... Weirdly, your fans are the only ones that I've seen in which you were their favourite personality. That's kind of quite odd. Oh. Usually the favourite personality, like, is the favourite TV show is your TV show and the favourite Twitter feed is your Twitter feed. Usually it's not the person that
so they normally have like another person that they love, but then you're their favourite comic. Oh, I don't know what you mean.
Well, it just
so what were yours? What were their favourite?
I can probably find out quickly, hold on. Richard Herring. Okay, here's me.
Here's
what it's like.
Mm-hmm.
So
fans
no
of Richard
else.
Herring, yeah.
Okay. Oh, it's not there is that's my fan. They live in London, they're very left wing. They work in construction.
Do you?
No. They've got £1,000 or more to spend, haven't you, every week? You lot, well done. Good work. Buy my fucking DVD.
They're 40 to 54.
Yeah, so then online they would go to it's taking its time, isn't it? There you go, Peep Show, Radiohead, and Jim will paint it.
Still better than Jim will fix it though.
I think it might be worse. I think that might be a Jimmy Savile.
Do you not know what Jim will paint it is?
Is it Jimmy Savile injecting paint into his testicles and then masturbating over dead bodies? That's what I'm imagining it is.
Do you know
what it is.
Jim will paint it is this. Do you know Jim will paint it? Yeah, it's really good, isn't it? It's really good. I don't know much about the person that does it, but I imagine he's called Jim.
Yeah.
But you can send in anything that you want. You can say you want to see you with your massive bollocks sort of shitting up a wall, and he'll do an illustration of that.
Okay.
And then, I mean, I wouldn't ask for that.
That's your fan. Look at your fan. How cool is she?
Is not my
headphones,
fan.
Headphones, one of those
18
cool
24?
Hats. Just very slightly to the left of centre. Work in translation. They've got less than £125 a week.
Spend it all on those fucking headphones, that's why.
And so then you go to entertainment. And in entertainment, Sarah Millican television programme. I think that might mean that people who like you are the only people who like you.
I can't work out if that's an insult or a compliment. That's all right, though.
It's a bit of both.
It means that they're loyal.
Look, Sarah Millican, top page, Sarah Millican. Sarah Millican at Sarah Millican 75. Eurovision TV.
What?
BuzzFeed.
This is great.
Yeah. This is their personality. Let's see what they say, your fans. I wish the internet was...
That's a
hat. I'm happy to spend money to support my favourite music artists, but not comedians.
I find toilet humour quite funny.
Quite funny. I wouldn't mind having a wind turbine in my area. That's what they think. apropos of nothing.
They say that loads. They haven't even been asked about wind turbines. Just bringing it up.
I wouldn't mind it, wouldn't mind it. Just letting you know. I like to spend my free time relaxing. Wow, you fucking maverick.
As opposed to what?
Doing extra work. I like to spend my free time going back to work translating some other stuff. Your fans like chocolate cake, garlic bread, tomato soup, cheese on toast, mashed potatoes.
This is literally my diet. This is my full diet.
That is the most... Look, I'll show you what my
are
fans
they,
are.
Oh, does it say what the average weight is? Are they all about my weight?
This is Richard Herring fans. This is what they like. Hold on.
Oh, how many letters of your name do you have to put in before?
A lot.
You have to put Richard H-E-R-R before it brings you up.
You come up after Sarah. I'm very annoyed about it. So where's the lifestyle? My fans eat... Look at that. Look how fancy you can see from the picture. Three bean chili is their favourite food. Salt and pepper chicken, chorizo sausage.
Oh, yours is proper middle class.
Look at this. Malay anchovy and pin ut sambal.
That's
the fucking
fourth,
mushroom
fourth,
soup.
Fourth favourite food.
Malay.
It's
Malay
something I've not even fucking heard
of. I tell you what it is. You know what it is? That's peanut. It looks because it's on two lines. It looks like it's, I said, pian ut sambal. It's the way they spaced it out, to be fair. I've read what they put. Chicken doner. Let's see where kimchi. I mean, there's fucking made up foods down here. My fans are eating gyros or gyros.
Who's their favourite personality, Eve? It's not you.
It's definitely not me. I think you'll find. I think you can probably have a little guess who it's going to be. Oh, no, that's their personality. Right. Their enter their favourite TV show is Stuart Lee's Comedy Bill. My favourite celebrity, Stuart Lee.
Oh, I feel bad for you now. I'm so sorry I brought it up.
Not really.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Well, maybe they're scrabbling for a programme with you in it. And they think that his programme is the next best thing because he knows you.
Yeah, they just imagine. They imagine me being in there.
Yeah, sort of standing side by side, being a smart ass. Exactly.
What are you doing, Stu? Where's the funny one, Stu? You worked as a civil servant.
I did.
I'm interested in your life before comedy. What did you have to do when you were a civil servant?
Oh, various things. I worked in a job centre for a while on the front line, signing people on and stuff. What else did I do? I worked, did job searches for people in a call centre environment, but still a job centre. Mm-hmm. And... I did another thing where people made a claim to benefit over the phone. That was one of my favourite ones because people didn't always know which benefit they were entitled to, so they would sometimes make up words. So the options were basically like job seekers allowance or income support, incapacity benefit, that sort of thing. And somebody once asked for in captivity benefit, which is obviously only for pandas, and also income spastity benefit. There was a lady once who rang up to claim, she wanted to see if she was entitled to bereavement benefit. So I was... Yes, that's right. Her husband had died, Lady Laughlin. And so she rang up and I sort of thought, well, she's possibly entitled. So we started to look at the form and things. And obviously you have to be very careful because this is a lady who's recently bereaved. So I was treading very carefully. And turned out what had happened was she'd split up with her husband 10 years ago, but they'd never officially divorced. And she read in the newspaper that he died. And she, I don't know, because we didn't see the outcome, we were just at the beginning, but if he paid enough stamp, she would have been entitled to that, because it's legal still.
Right.
And I thought, well done you on the fucking chutzpah of doing that. He was quite proud of her, weirdly. But yeah, so and then I did a job that I never really learnt. It was something to do with insurance. We were the only department that actually made money for the government.
Right.
And it was basically, you know, if it's really boring, sorry everybody, this is why I don't do this anymore. You know when somebody has an accident and then they claim that back on their insurance?
Yeah.
They make a claim on their insurance, sorry. If they received benefits during that time and that insurance company pays out, then we get those benefits back.
Okay, right, yeah.
So you're basically having conversations with lawyers a lot. But I never really learned it. I did it for 6 months and I never really learned because I was doing stand-up at the time. Right. So I'd constantly be on flexi time and I'd be leaving and getting a train to Lincoln and talking about cocks on stage and then going back in and then doing it. And I never really learned it. But they kept me around. They said I was a breath of fresh air. That's what they put in my leaving card, which was nice. because I didn't learn it and everyone else was really good, hard working member of staff. I was a breath of fresh air because I was just doing stand-up and loving stand-up. So that was the last thing that I did. But yeah, various different sort of officey jobs. Where met my best friend, that's nice. Met my best friend in the civil service. Okay. So yeah, it's kind of, you know, they were good jobs. I liked them, but I felt sort of untapped.
Right.
Because I'd wanted to write. Yeah. That was the main thing I wanted
to
do.
Well, you're writing plays and
yeah, I was writing plays and I had a column in the free paper and stuff like that. Yeah. So I knew I wanted to write, but I didn't really know where it was going to end up.
And you ran a comedy course in Spain?
Yeah, I did a few of those. So, you know, people can go on these holidays where they learn how to, like, they all sing or they all paint. And it was a few of those. I did three of those. Where the first one had Stephanie Merritt.
Yeah, that's why I read an article she wrote.
Yeah, yeah. And I was terrified because it was the first time I was doing it. I was teaching comedy and I'd only really learned how to do it. Like, I'm still learning now, but I was very new when I was doing these courses. And then you've got the observer critic who came on the course. And I just, luckily, she was really nice. And she had a nice time when we got on well. Because I just basically thought, I'm going to get a terrible review before I've even done a fucking show. But she was really nice. So yeah, it's kind of like a little holiday. And the people that were running the course were adorable. Really nice. So it was, it's just a daft thing I did. It was fun. Yeah.
And you were obviously doing stand-up at the same time. But this was before you'd broken...
Totally. Before I did Edinburgh or anything.
Yeah, interesting. Thanks. Very interesting. And at the moment, you are working on Standard Issue, which is an internet magazine.
It's a no bullshit women's magazine on the internet.
Yes.
Because I just kind of got a bit bored of the women's magazines that were out there.
So it was a no bullshit or a no bullshit?
Oh, a no bullshit.
Oh, no bullshit. Okay, yeah.
A no
it's bullshit. A no bullshit magazine.
Imagine one upper wall, if you will. A no bullshit magazine.
No bullshit.
I just kind of got bored of the women's magazines, and I'm not really interested in which lipstick I should wear and whether I'm an apple shape, or I don't give a shit at all about those things. And it just felt like they were often quite, you know, they just assume that women are only interested in really basic, simple things, and I thought that feels like cack to me. So I set up an online women's magazine. It's been going 3 years, and I'm very proud of it. I think it's excellent. We've got a really good team and really good writers, and it's just nice to. It's what I read. I kind of selfishly set up a thing so when I'm on a train, I don't have to read rubbish. I can read my own website, which is a bit much. It's a big thing to do just because you're a bit bored on the train.
No, it's good. And you're branching out into podcasts with it? You did a podcast there last night?
Yeah, we do shows. We did our first one here last night with me and Kathy Burke and Joe Brand all on the stage at the same time and just kind of having a chat and having a good laugh. And then we've got them in January, February, March and May.
Right.
Yeah, with just different
And just different that goes out on the website, on the Standard Issue website for free?
Yeah.
Terrific. I've tried to get both Kathy Burke and Joe Brand on this and they've always said they're too busy, so...
I just asked them and they said, pick a date, any date, my diary. My diary is wide open.
Did you spend any time with the Yemeni population in South Shields? It's got a famous Yemeni...
No, I didn't.
No, okay.
Sorry, was that going to be a big chunk of the show?
I was hoping that you'd have some stories about the Yemeni population of South Shields. Did you ever see a Yemeni person in South Shields?
Was this before my time?
It might be as well. I just got it off Twitter.
I think it's more recent than when I was there.
Some of them must still be... No, it's to do with the shipbuilding that used to go on there, but that doesn't really happen.
Oh, they don't know. They haven't done that in a long time.
No.
I mean, they did a lifeboat once, but we don't even know if that's true.
You do crafts, you made a get well card.
Oh, I sometimes get together. I like having a hobby that I don't have to be good at, you know, like, because when you're at work, everything has to be as good as it can possibly be. So then it's nice in your downtime to be able to go, I'm going to make an all right cake.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm going to try and grow something from seed. But I like being able to be rubbish at something. My rule with cooking, I'm very good at cooking, I'm all right. But my rule is that if nobody gets the shits, that was a success. Doesn't have to look like it is in the book. So with craft, a few of us get together, not very often, sadly, but every now and again, and just kind of, I've got a big tub of sort of, you know, kind of buttons and glue and glitter and shit. And we get together, but none of us are any good. Well, actually, one girl is pretty good, and we don't really like her. Don't like it when she joins. She's brilliant, but we don't like it when she joins it. You know when you go to karaoke and somebody can actually sing and it's really annoying? It's like that, but with painting. She's really good. But the rest of us are kind of shit. And I did make a Get Well Soon card for my best friend once, and she, it was so terrible that she pretended it was off her niece. It was really terrible, but I was so proud of it. You just have to put "Love Sarah, age 5" on the back, and then you can get away with anything. It's fun,
but I like, I make t-shirts for prizes and for Kickstarter and stuff. Yeah, I'm really bad. But I enjoy it so much.
Exactly. Isn't it nice having a hobby that it doesn't have to be exceptional? It can just be.
Well, I'm terrible.
Yeah.
I mean, they're literally.
It's quite
the
liberating,
worst.
Though.
Yeah. It's really good fun.
Yeah, I like.
But it's like I just I use fabric paints like a monkey would.
Like a sexy monkey.
Yeah, very sexy. Sexy monkey with a tiny penis. That is. I'll ask you an emergency question to get out of that one. What would, if you could jump into anything, what would you jump into a pool of anything if it was anything in the pool?
Custard.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Cold.
Cold custard.
Yeah, I don't like warm custard.
Okay.
I had old custard the other day. How, you know, if you have a tin of custard, how long past the best before day can you eat it, do you think?
What, it's like...
How long?
5 years.
5 years?
What, the dried
custard? No, a tin of, like, ambrosia, like the... 5 years, oh, I'll be all right then, won't I? It was only 3 months out of date.
Yeah.
Oh, some people are appalled at me.
My wife's
what,
a stickler.
What, am I supposed to eat a banana on its fucking own, am I? Who does that?
My wife is a stickler for sell-by dates.
I'm
very blasé.
My husband's blasé. Yeah. Maybe it's a man thing. I always say, just, you know, bin it if it's out of date. And he, but the custard thing, it was 2 a.m. and we really wanted bananas and custard. And he was like, he told me a story about some tin that was found that dated back to the Second World War. And he said, and they ate that. And I went, is that the end of the story? Like, you don't know if they died. And he didn't know, but we ate it. And I talked myself into a bad stomach. You know, and you just think, I'm going to have a bad stomach. Yeah. And then I had a bad stomach, mostly psychosomatic. But 5 years is good to know, Flower. Thank you. Are you? Is that your field?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. He works in nuclear physics.
It's good enough.
Yeah. He generally does. I know the professions of everyone in the front two rows.
So nice.
Where? What is? Hold on. Did any future celebrities other than you go to your school, or who was the most famous person who went to
my school? No, I don't think so.
Did no one who went on to be like? Doesn't even have.
No,
to
there's
be
people from South Shields, but they don't think my school.
Who was the most famous person who visited your school when you were at school?
Kevin Smith's dad, who was a diver. Genuinely, we were fascinated by his job. Yeah. No famous people came to the school, I don't think. Famous people from South... So South Tyneside was known for, like, Catherine Cookson was from South Tyneside.
Oh, okay.
Chris Ramsey's from South Shields.
Yeah.
I think some of Little Mix, but I haven't paid that much attention, if I'm honest. But, yeah, I don't think anybody else from my school... Oh, am I the famous person in my school?
You might be.
Oh, God.
Have you been invited back to do talks at school?
No, I did a talk at a different school in the same town because my friend was a teacher there.
Okay.
And I talked before I'd been on the telly. She had, like, fun jobs, so I went in with a fun job.
Yeah.
And I told them all they didn't really have to go to university. And the teachers all were like, what the fuck is she saying? And it's true, they didn't, because I didn't, and I'm doing all right.
Good.
I mean, I don't want them all to be comics, because that's too much competition.
There's a lot. There's too much competition. I wouldn't like to start now.
You
What year did you start in?
2004.
Yeah, so
maybe.
It was just... that was when I was about, when I was sort of coming back to it, and it was sort of manageable, I think, then for new people to come into it. But now so many new people are doing it, I don't understand how they even get beyond...
No, I went from, like, the first open spot to, I think it was about a year.
Right.
That was quite rare then,
yeah,
to be in full-time. And I had an agent and went full-time about a year, maybe a year and a half, not long. But I think some people who are really good just can't make that jump now because there's more comics than there are gigs, unfortunately.
Yeah. So do not become a comedian if you are listening to this and like
this
comedy.
Yeah, this is what we're trying to pass off so that nobody else does it.
How do you sleep at night?
I'm taking you literally.
Yeah, good, you should do.
On my chest.
Do you?
Yeah.
Is that quite comfy?
I have to have a cushion under my feet just to balance me off. No, I sleep, quite comfy. Yeah. I generally sleep very still. I wake up in the same position I fell asleep in. But my husband is a regular.
Is he?
Are you a regular?
I think I am a bit. My wife gets very annoyed. I snore really badly.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
What does she do about that? Does she elbow you, or does she tell you to wake up? Or
she's very passive aggressive, so she'll not do much, and then she'll basically just
ruin your life the next day.
Yeah, well, I've just hit me, or like she went ah the other day like that.
And hit you?
No, just hit the bed.
Hit the bed.
Yeah.
I used to. My husband.
And then, well, what? But I snore so badly I wake myself up snoring. And like I, but also I'm snoring. I can. Well, sometimes I'm snoring and I'm still awake and I can't hear it.
Right.
So then she goes, "You're snoring." And I go, "I'm not. I'm still awake." And she goes, "You're snoring." So I think I'm awake, but I'm asleep. Or
you're dreaming.
Or
that
she's
you're
dreaming.
Awake.
She might be dreaming that I'm snoring.
You've lost me, I think.
Well, I'm lying there. I think, I wish I could get to sleep. Stop snoring. I'm awake. And I'm not snoring.
God, that's so awful that your dream is not being able to get to sleep. I once woke myself up snoring and made my ex-husband, as is now, go downstairs with a bat because I was sure there was somebody in the house because I heard a noise. But it was
the old lady in the drains.
My husband doesn't snore, either he doesn't snore or I have become a heavier sleeper and I don't notice, which is quite possible. But I used to move around on the bed and that woke him up to a lighter level of sleep. And then I'd try and desperately get back to sleep before he went back down into the snory sleep.
Yeah, right.
So she could try that.
Yeah.
But I think what she's doing sounds great.
Yeah.
I like what she's doing. I think she could hit you as well.
I think I just will wake up and be dead one day. I'll be stabbed.
Oh no. Just get some of those things that open your nostrils up. Yeah. Those little tabs.
I just gotta lose some weight. So when I've lost some weight.
I don't mean I mean generally, We all need to do that though. When's that gonna happen? Maybe we could do it after Edinburgh, and then we decided no, we might as well wait till we get Christmas out the way, just like 5 months after Edinburgh. 4 months. And now we might as well wait till January, eh? Might as well, because you've got to eat all the matchmakers and the stuff over Christmas. So January, I'll probably start trying to lose a bit of weight.
Yeah, good idea. Me too.
I don't care enough, that's the problem. Yeah.
Sometimes I do, but just at the moment I don't.
Well, I think I'd like to fill this part of my jeans still. They're still, like, when I get on a plane and there's 6 inches of the seatbelt left before I then have to get an extender, rather than thinking, we should lose a bit of weight, I just think, 6 more inches. So I'll do that.
Have you ever flown a kite?
No. I haven't ever. It's never. I wasn't outdoorsy. You see, I had an imaginary library, but I've never flown a kite.
An imaginary
library.
Library.
All
an
my
imaginary
books.
Library.
Yeah. So the books were real. So and I ticketed them all.
That's not an imaginary library. That's a library.
Well, it is.
You imagine they were on some shelves. Imagine they were catalogues and there was a Dewey Decimal System.
It wasn't an open to the public library because it was my bedroom.
Okay.
And the only customers that came in were teddy bears.
Okay.
So it was technically an imaginary library. But they were all alphabetized.
Yeah.
The first one was Janet and Alan Alberg's The Ha Ha Bonk book, which was a joke book.
Okay.
And it was excellent.
Yes. Do you use any of the material from that in your act?
No. I think I might start though.
Good. That's not the answer to, do you ever flown a kite? I had an imaginary library. How did that happen?
Have you ever flown a kite?
Yeah.
Why?
Because it seemed like...
It's a good question, isn't it? It's a good fucking question.
I remember being very excited about having a kite. I remember we got a kite with green shield stamps, and I was very excited about it, and I thought it was the most exciting. It's boring once you try.
What colour was it?
With orange.
Oh, is that like orange?
Yeah. And it was free. What are green shield stamps? It's a free kite.
Yeah, how many times did you take it out?
I'm not sure. Probably not very many.
Yeah, so
one.
Was that really worth it, all that hassle?
It was because it was fun. Do you remember Green Shield stamps?
Yeah, vaguely. Sorry.
Who remembers Green Shield? Do you remember Green Shield stamps?
Yes.
This isn't... Who remembers Green Shield stamps?
Yeah.
Yeah, not good enough. Most people.
Most people.
Well, I'm looking for something that only one person remembers. Peter Kay could do that as material. And people would go... His audience would go, yeah! You're just like, yeah. I remember stuff, Rich. You have to do better than that for us. We're not just going to be told, how do you remember things? It was exciting. I can remember the smell of it. I can remember the perforations of green shield stamps sticking them in. Do you remember Typhoon? Do you remember PG Tips cards?
No.
Who remembers those? Yeah. Too many people. Yeah, we remember. We remember things, Rich. Stop telling us about it. Tell us something we don't know.
Am I too old to have a kite now?
You too old? No, you should.
41.
Should
I give it a go?
Perfect time.
Do they have to run though?
I don't
Can
think you do.
Can you do a brisk walk?
I think if you get up on top of a hill,
and then
chuck it up.
Oh, okay.
I don't know how it works. Get a stunt kite.
What's the difference between that and a kite?
It can do stunts.
Oh, it's not like a pretendy kite. I don't know why I thought it was like...
It's like something that isn't a kite, that when the kites get into dangerous situations, like it does the... Yeah.
It goes in and does the flying for the more famous kite that's got too much insurance. Maybe I'll get a kite then. Maybe that's what I've learned tonight.
I'll get you a kite. I'm going to buy you a kite.
Are you? Yeah. Do I have to go out with you with it? Or
I'm going to be on the kite.
Are you going to make me a kite with your fabric paints?
I'm going to stand very still and go, oh, that's a good picture of Richard. That's like a three-dimensional sculpture.
You're going to be the kite?
Yeah, I'm just going to be on the kite. It's going to be like Jesus on a kite.
How windy do you think it fucking is?
Pretty windy up where we live up north, right?
Yeah, but it's not that windy that it could lift a man into the air.
I've seen Game of Thrones, it's like that, isn't it?
Yeah, it's exactly like that.
Chuck me off that big
wall.
More
tits, yeah.
Well, we've had a lovely time. We might be coming to the end. I think it's 5-0. I think we can all agree on that.
I think this might have been a draw, this one.
Yeah, we've been quite nice to each other, though.
We
haven't really tried to be unpleasant.
Yeah, you've not been as sort of predatory as you often are, either. Sort of disappointed, if I'm honest. I shaved my legs and everything. Just the fronts, obviously.
I prefer the other side. So it's chosen poorly. Do any of our VIP guests want to ask Sarah a question? Don't have to. No.
Rude.
Are you scared?
Yeah. Oh, don't be
Tom,
scared.
Does Tom Sawyer want to ask a question? Why do I not exist? Why am I a fictional character? It's been lovely to see you. What's coming? You're not touring now. You've got a bit of a break.
No, I've got a break. Yes, and I write the next show. Live a bit. Write the next show. Then take that on tour. So it's mostly I'm doing DVD promotional stuff at the moment, and then a bit of time off over Christmas.
Time off?
Yeah.
You work ridiculously hard.
Well, I hope so. I want to, but also I need a bit of. Yeah, I just go a bit mad if I don't. I'm too much of a work. You're a workaholic.
I am a bit, but I think even I look at you and think this is your tours are enormously massive and gone for
it. It was a year. Months.
Yeah.
It was.
So how many dates did you do?
185.
Yeah, that's big. That's a big tour.
But that's because I think people who are covering that amount of audience members might go to arenas and then they just have to do like 30 dates or something or probably less, and I don't want to do arenas because I don't think they're suitable for me. I don't even take the mic out the stand, so I think it's alright for people who are very physical, but it doesn't suit me.
No.
So I end up doing a year on tour, but I love my job, so it's like, do you want to do a year doing the thing you love? Yes. But then it's nice because like a week afterwards I get a migraine for a whole week afterwards because just your body just doesn't understand why you're not doing anything and why you're at home and you're not in a car somewhere. But then it's nice to live a bit because you've got to live a bit, so you've got something to talk about on the next one.
Absolutely. And also just enjoy. Do you get back home?
Oh, that sounds bad. Like the only reason I want time off is so that I can write more material.
But do you get back home when you do it? Because you're in the middle of the country.
I don't, because you go place to place to place,
don't you?
I try and get home. If it's less than 2.5-hour drive, I'm not going to stay overnight.
Yeah.
Because I don't sleep till 3 a.m, maybe 2 at the earliest. So if I can be in my own bed for that time, then I'd rather do that. So, it's on the road, but it's not like you're on the road. I don't go place to place to place. Yeah.
Mine's less so.
You're trying to get home.
I try to get home as well.
So you can look at your baby more than the once.
That's probably the
best.
She's got a face and it's good to
look at. You can snore at your wife. Yeah. She's fucking thrilled that you're coming home more often.
She's going, can't you stay a bit longer like you did in the old days?
When I married you, you stayed away for 10 nights in a row. It was great.
Well, we'll look forward to the next tour, which by the time this comes out, it'll probably be starting just about to start. And buy your new DVD, Outsider.
Yeah, I mean, only if you want to. Don't feel like you have to.
I don't think they feel obliged to do anything. This audience.
That's all right. That's good. That's good.
Buy my new DVD, Happy Now, and you have to. You have to do it.
If you only buy one DVD,
you have to.
Then get Ramesh Ranganathan. He's really good. He's really good.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Sarah Millican. We'll be back next week. How'd you like them sky potatoes?